This is Unit 6, Lesson 10 for 7th grade Algebra 1. In this lesson, we're going to be looking at sampling methods and biased and unbiased sampling methods. This is a very vocabulary heavily focused lesson, so it's important that you learn the language that is associated with this type of material. So as mentioned, we're going to talk about different types of sampling methods and learning to identify whether they are biased or unbiased sampling methods. And if we do have unbiased sampling methods, then we will learn how to draw inferences about a population in order to answer different questions. This lesson of itself is an application problem. You are exposed to data every day and things that say survey says this, or people say this, or 3 out of 5 dentists recommend this. And you need to understand and know what data was appropriately or not appropriately collected, and whether it's biased or unbiased, so that you know whether that information is accurate and can be drawn to a larger population. Here is an application problem that we'll look at later in the lesson. As I said, there's a lot of vocabulary with this lesson, so we'll start with the basics. The population. The population represents whatever you're looking at. It could be a group of people. It could be schools across the Pennsylvania. It could be schools across the United States. It could be different sports teams within a league. So whatever that group of items or people may be. And then normally when we're conducting surveys or gathering information, it's not necessarily feasible to get information from everyone within the population or every item that's on the conveyor belt going through the factory. And so we sample it. We take a smaller group of that total and we look at what information they have to provide us and try to draw a connection from what is happening here in the sample and try to refer it back to the entire population. An unbiased sample should have some criteria being met. An unbiased sample should be representative of the entire population. So for example, if we're trying to sample the opinions of students in the middle school, which has 6th, 7th, and 8th grade, you wouldn't want to just select information or have a sample of students who are just only 8th graders, because then you're neglecting or ignoring the opinions of the 7th and the 6th graders. When you are selecting your sample, it has to be done in a way that is random or without preference, and we'll talk about some ways that that can be done here in the future slides. And your sample population needs to be big enough. If you have 500 students in a school, collecting a sampling of 10 students isn't necessarily going to be representative or large enough to represent that whole population. If the sample is too small, then your data may not actually represent the whole population, and then you can't make inferences about your data that you've collected, which is the whole point of having a sample, is to try to glean understanding of what the whole population feels or believes or knows. So there are several different types of unbiased sampling. So this would be ways of getting a sample in a way that is non-preferential and is unbiased. So the first way is just to have some sort of a simple random sample where everyone gets some sort of identifying mark, such as a number or a letter or something like that, and then we somehow randomly select them. So maybe we have a computer program that randomly selects 100 names from a list, or we put all the names in a hat and we select those names from a hat, things like that. Everyone has an equal chance of being selected. A stratified random sample is when you have a population that you can divide into smaller subgroups, and then you randomly select from each of those groups. The middle school is a perfect example of that, where you have your whole school, but then within the school, you have 6th, 7th, and 8th grade. And so you randomly select a group of students from 6th, randomly select some from 7th, randomly select some from 8th, and then those three groups merge together to make your sample group. But again, however you're selecting those students needs to be random and unbiased. Another way is to select objects or people on some sort of interval, which we call a systematic random sample. So for example, if we're at a store, we could talk to the customer who comes in every 20 minutes. So every 20 minutes that goes by, that next customer that comes in, that's the person that we talk to and select for our sample. The reason why that is random is that we don't control who comes into the store. So we don't know, it's random because we don't know who's going to come in next at that 20 minute mark. Another way is just to select a certain number on an interval. So for example, you can see here that we are selecting every 10th customer. Or if you look at the image, it looks like we are selecting every third person. A bias sample is what we want to prevent. A bias sample is when they're not selected in some sort of random way, and as a result of that, our data is skewed and does not represent the overall population. So in a bias sample, someone or some group or object is favored over another part. Here are some ways that bias sampling can occur. Bias sampling can confer based on a convenient sample. Convenient sample is when you select a sample because it was easy to get a hold of those people or objects. An easy example would be for me as your teacher, if I selected you, my students, as being a sample to represent the rest of the school. You were very easy to get access to because I see you every day in class. However, you might not represent the entire population. You as an algebra student in 7th grade don't necessarily have the same opinions as a 6th grader or an 8th grader who is a Math 8 or an Algebra 2. A voluntary response sample is one that you really have to watch for in real life when you are a consumer of data and trying to analyze whether it is meaningful or not. Voluntary response is exactly what it sounds like. People volunteer to provide their input. The reason why that's bad is because only the people who wanted to participate provide the data. And we'll look at some examples of that in this lesson. Another thing about voluntary response samples is that perhaps one group is left out because of a certain condition. For example, if you look at the example provided, you can see that the principal was collecting votes through a smartphone app. Well, not every student at the middle school owns a smartphone, so then their opinions or information would not be collected on that survey, which makes it biased. Only people who have cell phones and can use the smartphone app will be able to give their opinion. If you have an unbiased survey and sampling, the main goal of conducting and gathering that information from that sample is to try to make an inference, to try to draw a conclusion about the data that you've collected. And normally that conclusion will relate back to the entire population. So if I select a random group of 6th, 7th, and 8th graders and glean some information about them, such as how much time do you play video games on your phone? And then I take that information and let's just say 40% of the students play games on their cell phones. And then I try to make that connection and say, okay, well, if I talk to 100 people in the school out of 500 students and 40% of them play games on their phones, then perhaps 40% of the 500, all of the students in the school, also play on their phones. And we'll look at examples like that in this lesson as well. We can have a valid inference, meaning drawing a valid conclusion, when we have a large enough population being sampled, and we know that it is representative of that population, meaning that it's unbiased, and that it's large enough, and that it represents the entire group. When you're looking at data in real life, or being presented data in the news or on the internet, they will often make inferences, but then you have to ask yourself, Is the inference or the conclusion they're drawing a valid inference based on how they collected the data? So here's everything put into practice. So here we could have the entire population of the school district. We're having some sort of survey. And we're going to choose 200 of those students out of about 2,500 students in the district to answer some survey questions. So a good way to get those 200 students is to have some sort of random sample. So maybe we pick their names from a hat. All the students' names are in the hat. They all have an equal chance of being selected. That is a random, unbiased sampling method. You could also have a computer program randomly pick students from a roster of the entire school population. A biased sampling would be to only pick 200 students who have had Mr. Schwab as their teacher. That is a biased sampling method because then you're not looking for the opinions or the input of the students who did not have Mr. Schwab. I have not had all of the students that are in the school district. There are actually the vast majority of students I do not have, but their opinions matter also in this situation. An inference may sound like this, that if we ask those 200 randomly selected people what their favorite ice cream flavor was from those five flavors, and we conclude that out of those 200 students, we learn that 75 of those 200 students like chocolate as their favorite, and that turns into 37.5%. So the inference would be that I'm now going to infer that if 37.5% of the 200 like chocolate ice cream, then if I have a student population of 1,500, then I can find 37.5% of 1,500 to determine that out of all of the students in the district, about 563 students in the entire district prefer chocolate as their favorite ice cream. This is a valid inference. If we have randomly chosen those 200 students, then we can make the above connection between the sample and the population. So now we're going to practice identifying whether things are biased or unbiased, and then we'll look at some sampling and inference problems. So to determine the types of music their customers like, so this is for some sort of a business, all the people attending a concert of a country music singer were surveyed. So is this an example of a biased or an unbiased sampling method? And if it's unbiased or biased, which type is it? Well, if their customers only like country music, then yeah, this is okay. But the odds are that if you have a business, not all of your customers are not going to be fans of country. So this is a biased sampling method. It's biased because we are only surveying people who like country music, and we're not getting input from the people who do not like country music. Now, what type of surveying method is this? This would be a convenient sample. It's convenient because they're there. You don't have to, they're all at the concert. You don't have to go out and call people or send them surveys or anything like that. The people, you have a enclosed group of people that are all right there ready for you to ask them questions. I'm going to write out the rest of the reasoning and then you can write it down for yourself. So just to clarify that we were asking these attendees of the concert what types of music they like. And clearly, if you're going to a country concert, you probably are more inclined to like country music and not other types of music. So that's part of what makes it biased as well. So people at a country concert are more inclined to say country is their favorite, thus skewing the results of the survey to favor country. You can go ahead and pause the video and write down your answer, and then we can move on to the next problem. To determine which passengers' carry-on bags are inspected, every eighth person to check in will have his or her bag inspected. Identify whether this is biased or unbiased, describe the type, and explain your reasoning. Well, if you look here, there is a system to how, or a rhythm or a pattern to how I'm selecting a person to have their bag inspected. It's every eighth person. So this would be a unbiased method because you don't know who that eighth person is that shows up. It depends on when they arrive at the airport and when they get to that part of the airport where things are being inspected. So this would be unbiased. And it is a systematic random sample. Now, the reasoning is what we just talked about, is that you're picking people at random. And so I'll write the rest of the explanation, and then you can write it down for yourself. So my final explanation is, since every eighth person is being checked, that's an interval, that's what makes it a systematic random sample, the sample is not biased, since the inspector does not know who will be the eighth person each time. It's left up to chance or a random sampling. A pet store mailed a survey to residents to determine their favorite pets. 50 people responded, and the results are shown in the table. Which, honestly, it doesn't really matter whether there's a table or not. I see that there is no table. I have no table. However, it does not matter. Is this a valid sampling method? And the answer is no. Take a second to think about, why is sending out a survey to the community and getting 50 people to respond, why that's not a valid sampling method? Well, it's not a valid sampling method because it's voluntary. You can't force the community to respond to your survey. Those 50 people that responded, they wanted to respond. And so you're getting feedback from people who really probably have some sort of a strong opinion about what kind of pet they like, or people that don't have pets might not even want to bother filling out the survey. It's not worth their time since they don't really care about animals. So this is a biased sampling. And the reason why it's biased is because it's a voluntary response. Now, it doesn't ask for further explanation, but I do have written in the notes that because the survey is mailed, only those who want to complete the survey will send it back. Therefore, it's not random. It's voluntary. Only the people who want to fill it out will. And so you might want to add that into your notes. And so since it's biased, I can't answer this second part of the question because it's biased. The people who fill out the survey may really like dogs or may really like cats, and it doesn't necessarily represent all of the community as a whole, which appears to be what this survey was trying to determine. What was the general community's favorite pet? Mr. Spangler surveyed every 10th student in the hallway to see where they would prefer to go on vacation. 48% preferred to go to the beach, 36% preferred an amusement park, and 16% preferred the mountains. Is this a valid sampling method? Well, the answer to that question is yes. It's based on a interval of selection. So is it valid? Yes. What kind is it? It is a systematic random sample because we're doing every 10th student that he sees in the hallway. Now, because it is a random sample that is unbiased, then we can answer the next part of the question, which says, hey, if there are 450 students in the school, how many of them would prefer a beach vacation? Well, let's look back at the information we're given. We were told based on the survey that 48% preferred the beach. So 48% of however many students there were preferred the beach as their favorite. And so if 48% of that small group liked the beach, then we can extrapolate or infer that perhaps the overall population of 450 students believes the same thing. So if we find 48% of 450, and we did similar problems, percent problems earlier on in this chapter in lessons 6 and 7 and 8, when we find 48% of 450, we end up with 216 students want the beach. So, back at the beginning of the lesson, when we were talking about drawing an inference, that's what we were talking about. That if 48% of this small group liked the beach, then how many out of the entire group would like the beach? So we extrapolated, and since we had a random sampling, we can infer more accurately, or assuming that the trend follows, that it applies to the overall population. And again, this is still a sampling and an estimating method. It may not be exactly 48%. It may that we got really lucky and talked to a lot of people that really liked the beach. But then the rest of the school that we didn't talk to, maybe a lot of them like the other activities. But it's a way to try to sort of estimate or infer perhaps what the overall community wants or likes. Here we have from a batch of 7,500 computer chips that were produced, the manufacturer samples every 150th chip to see if they're defective. And they happen to find two defective chips. Is this a valid sampling method? And then if it is, it asks us to figure out how many defective chips there would be from the entire population of chips, 7,500. So the first thing we need to decide is whether it's biased or not. Because we're doing it on an interval, every 150th chip is being sampled, then yes, it is a valid sampling method. So this is a systematic random sample, just as the previous problem. So is it valid? Yes. So now we can try to determine the rest of the question. So in order to figure out how many defective chips there are in 7,500, I need to know how many chips were sampled to begin with. And so you have to be careful here because it says every 150th chip was selected. And so the first thing we need to do is figure out how many chips were actually selected then from the total population. So if I take 7,500, and I divide it by 150, that's going to tell us how many of the chips were actually looked at. And so when I divide that and I get 50 chips, that is my sample population. And so there were 50 chips sampled, and out of those 50 chips, 2 out of 50 were defective. So now I can change that into a percent. So 2 out of 50, so we'll divide that into a decimal and multiply by 100. And we get 4% were defective. And so because we have a valid sampling method, we are going to infer that that percent of defectiveness, 4%, extends to the 7,500 population. And so we could find 4% of 7,500. And when we multiply those together, we get 300 defective chips. And that is out of the 7,500. In this problem, we had to calculate how many chips were sampled first in order to figure out the percent that were defective in that sample, which we determined to be 4%. Once we determined the 4% defective rate, then we applied that to the entire population of 7,500 to get 300 defective chips. That company may want to fix that. That is actually a little high for this type sort of situation. So let's look at one more, and then there'll be two for you to try. Mr. Hunsberger plans to play music during lunch. To determine what type of music students prefer, 25 students with MP3 players and/or smartphones in one lunch period were asked what type of music they prefer. 16 said they preferred country. Is this a valid sampling method? And if it is, determine how many students out of the whole student population, 450, preferred to have country music. Is this biased or unbiased? Is this a valid sampling method if I pick 25 students with MP3s and smartphones in one lunch period? Well, it's not, for two reasons. One, not every student will have an MP3 player or a smartphone, particularly at the middle school level. And so you're only getting the opinion of students that have those devices and not getting the input of the other students. The other problem with this, and again, if you're not familiar with this school district, is that we have two lunch periods. And if you're only asking people from one lunch period, then you're ignoring the opinions and inputs from the other. So a better way would be some sort of a random sampling from both lunch periods and then combining that data together. So is this a valid method? No. And why? Well, it's a convenient sample. It's easy to ask those groups of people in one period. It's easy to see whether they have a smartphone or MP3 player, and during one lunch period as opposed to two. So I'm not going to write down the rest of the explanation, but I'll read it to you, and then you can write down as much as you want so that you understand the problem. So students without MP3s or smartphones are not asked, and also students that are in the other lunch period are not asked. So the people being asked don't necessarily represent the entire population, which we sort of already talked about that earlier. This problem is for you to do, so go ahead and pause the video. Identify whether the sampling being done is biased or unbiased and describe what type, and then explain your reasoning. Then resume the video to see the answer. So here we have a hardware store that wants to get feedback on its products and service. And so they include a telephone number, which is a very common practice, or perhaps a website or a link on the receipt for their customers to complete this survey and participate. Well, this is a very biased sampling because it is based on a voluntary response. Only the people who choose to make that phone call, in this case, are going to be the ones providing their opinions. The ones that don't either have the time or don't want to bother with that will not be providing their input, even if they do like or not like certain services about the store. And you can see the rest of my explanation there, which is what I just said. This problem is for you to do, so go ahead and pause the video, determine whether it is a valid sampling method, and then if it is, then go ahead and determine out of 380 people how many people at the restaurant would eat dessert based on the sampling data, and then resume the video to see the answer. After finishing their meal, every fifth person who left the restaurant was surveyed about whether they ordered dessert after their meals. Out of 20 people, 12 said yes. Is this a valid sampling method? And if so, about how many of the 380 people who had dinner at the restaurant ate dessert? So is it valid? Yes. It's valid because it's systematic. We asked every fifth person. We don't know who's going to finish and leave and when, and so that is a valid sampling method. So in order to figure out how many people out of 380 in the restaurant would have dessert, the first thing you should do is calculate what percentage of the people in the sample had dessert. Well, if 12 out of 20 had dessert, that is 60%. So we're going to infer then that if 60% of the sample ate dessert, then 60% of the entire population of 380 people chose dessert, since we had a valid sampling method. And as talked about before, it may not be exactly that amount, but it gives us an idea or a way to estimate what the general population would do or believes or thinks, or about particular items on an assembly line. So we wanted to then find what was 60% of the entire population of 380 people went to the restaurant. And when we do that math, 0.6 times 380, you get 228 people out of the total of 380 would have ordered dessert at the restaurant. So in this lesson, we talked about how to take random samples, different methods that you can use, and whether your sampling method is biased or unbiased, and then making an inference based on that information. There was a lot of vocabulary in this lesson that you need to be familiar with and practice so that you have an understanding of how to answer questions on your homework and a test. And more importantly, in real life, when you're looking at survey results in the news or on the internet. This completes the lesson. You are now ready to begin the homework.